For this case, the patient presents with existing PFM restorations on tooth numbers 8 and 9. You can see the classic PFM appearance, especially in the anterior, where the restorations and soft tissue have quite a bit of a gray appearance. Having been endodontically treated, the exposed dark tooth structure also lends to the poor aesthetics of these teeth. The contours could also be improved, so we do want to enhance this patient's aesthetic situation with some new restorations. And there's also another reason why we do want to replace these. As you can see in the radiograph, a periapical radiolucency on number 8. We will refer this patient to an endodontist for the retreatment. Before that happens, we are going to make things easier for the endodontist to perform their retreatment by removing the old restorations and provisionalize the teeth. Dr. Manalili is going to begin the treatment by removing the PFM restorations. Here in this first appointment, she's making a vertical cut through the facial aspect of both 8 and 9, starting off with a fine grit diamond burr. She likes using a diamond burr to cut through the feldspathic porcelain to the metal substructure, and then changes to a carbide 557 burr to finish off through the metal aspect of these restorations, which typically a carbide burr cuts through metal substructure relatively quickly. Typically, I just go straight to a 557 myself, but that's what's kind of cool about dentistry. Everyone has their own way to get from A to B. Cutting through the PFMs has actually become one of my favorite things because you can kind of zip through those old crowns because it's a lot more obvious once you make it through the metal and see the tooth structure. You still need to be careful though because the transitions can come very quickly. Once the crowns are removed, she switches back to a round-end tapered diamond and 856-018 burr to smooth and refine the prep to establish a nice chamfered margin. Here, she's packing a size 0 cord down into the sulcus, and that helps drop the gingival margins apically a bit, so she can further reduce those gingival margins on the preps for a better aesthetic outcome for the future restorations. At this point, she's preparing for the digital impression. Here she removes the cords, and as the cords should provide a good amount of tissue deflection to expose those margins. She's taking the case through the Glidewell.io in-office solution to fabricate BioTemps NOW provisional restorations. BioTemps are a long-lasting PMMA acrylic material that mills out very quickly, with each of these restorations milling out in less than 10 minutes. This is the quickest way to get a perfect fitting restoration in a very short amount of time. Once the restorations are milled out, you can achieve a very nice finish on these restorations using a chairside composite polishing system. In this case, Dr. Manalili uses the Venus Super Polishing Kit to achieve a nice smooth surface and a great luster on these provisional restorations. These BioTemps are now temporarily cemented using Temp-Bond Clear. As you can see, the excess clear cement is extruded beyond the margins. This cement does have a light activation component to it, so with a few seconds of light curing, the cement accelerates into the gel phase, making cleanup a breeze. This is one of my favorite cements to clean up, as you can see how easily it is to separate off the margins in a very nice solid piece. And with the floss knot, you can see how effectively the interproximal areas can be cleared out. Now on to our second appointment. The patient has now received their endodontic retreatment, and we will remove these BioTemps NOW restorations and see what we will need to do to finalize the preps. I'm using an 856-018 round-end tapered diamond to remove the IRM from the access cavity on number 8, carefully making my way down to the protective barrier left by the endodontist. After I pop the cotton pellet out, I use a slow-speed round carbide to gently remove any remaining IRM and sealer from the access channel. To prep for the fiber post, I'll etch the area with 37% phosphoric acid for 10 seconds, rinse and dry, and then scrub 3M's Scotchbond Universal into the tooth structure as I will bond the post with 3M's adhesive resin cement RelyX Ultimate. After suctioning the excess and air thinning the adhesive, we light cure for 10 seconds. A thin layer of adhesive is also applied to the post and cured. Cement is applied to both the canal and the post and seeded slowly to help minimize the risk of bubbles. The post I'm using is Colteen's Parapost Taper Lux. The tapered nature fits really well into the canal space with good retentive features. Once it's seated, I'm applying apical pressure while we fully cure the top for 20 seconds. Whatever cement you use, make sure it's a self or dual cure so that the deeper area is set properly. For the rest of the buildup, I'm using the rest of my discontinued camouflage flowable composite. Flowable works well and has good mechanical properties, but dedicated buildup materials are going to be cheaper for these purposes. Once the composite is dropped into place, I use an explorer to pop air bubbles that form and to tease the material into place so there's a nice transition to the tooth. Now it's back to the round end tapered diamond to eliminate the top of the post and refine the preps. You can see here, I'm dropping the mesial margin apically so we can establish a better emergence profile of the final restorations. If you recall, there was quite a large black triangle between the previous crowns. Anytime you want to close a space or minimize black triangles, a more apical margin position can assist you and the lab to create a better emergence for those restorations. If the margins are set too high, any attempt to accomplish the closure will be more of a ridge lap, which can have an undesirable appearance in these aesthetic areas. So initially, I wasn't planning on redoing the buildup on number 9, but I noticed some voids during the prep refinement, so now I'm removing as much of the buildup without disturbing the post. I switched to a flame-shaped diamond to carefully remove material between the post and tooth structure. And as you'd expect, the post loses retention and is now removed. Now I'll repeat the same fiber post process as I did on number 8. First, establishing enough width and depth of at least about 2/3 down the osseous root length to accommodate the post. Now we etch, bond, and using RelyX Ultimate once again. After the preps are refined, I like using a composite polisher to help smooth and round over any sharp line angles. This will help create a much better adaptation for today's digitally fabricated all-ceramic materials. To ensure we can visualize our prep margins, I'm seeding a hemodent-soaked size 1 Ultrapack knitted cord down into the sulcus. This is really important for equigingival and subgingival margins to help provide good tissue retraction. While that cord is seated, we begin our digital impression sequence by first scanning the lower arch with the iTero Element 2, slowly sweeping the wand along the occlusal, incisal, lingual, and facial surfaces to build the digital model. Next, I remove the cord from the preps, dry the area really well, and begin scanning the upper arch following a similar scanning pattern. With digital impressions, it's important to follow the pattern that maximizes the scanner's acquisition ability and also to evaluate the digital model as it's building to ensure the critical areas for restorative accuracy and precision are filled in. So basically for the prep side, I'm double checking to make sure all of the preps, margins, contact surfaces of the adjacent teeth, and most of the neighboring dentition are captured properly. And when I say margins, really ensure there was proper tissue retraction provided and that you can see where you basically stop prepping on the teeth. If you can't see it, the lab can't see it. The beauty with digital is you have this opportunity to go back and improve any aspect of your prep on the patient and make edits to your impression straight away. Once the upper, lower, and bite are captured, the digital file is open on my Chairside Fast Design workstation. The first step of any design is identifying the margin position. The ease of this step is entirely dependent on how well you prep and expose the margins on the patient. This dark model that I just activated is actually the pre-treatment scan of the BioTemps provisionals before we remove them. Since those represented a good midline and incisal edge position, I wanted to reestablish these aspects for the new design. The software is able to copy and paste the contours of the pre-treatment model for the new designs. Once the copy is made, we can evaluate the overall contours and relationship of the design with the adjacent teeth and opposing dentition. With the popularity of the fully centered BruxZir NOW material in the posterior, Glidewell has now expanded Chairside solid zirconia to the anterior with BruxZir Esthetic NOW, which has improved translucency for restorations in the aesthetic zone, and it's still incredibly durable at over 900 megapascal of flexural strength. Here you can see the cylindrical shape of the BruxZir Esthetic NOW block to maximize efficiency for milling this fully centered material. After the designs are sent to the fast mill, it's easy to seat and tighten the blocks into place. Each block also comes with a single-use diamond burr. Once the job starts, the fully electric fast mill takes over. There's lots of water spray during the milling to ensure the burr and the materials are kept cool. After 45 minutes, our completed crown is now removed from the mill. The mill, as you can see, thins out the sprue connection, and it makes it real easy to separate from the mandrel. Once I snap the crown at the sprue, I'm using the long tapered diamond from the BruxZir adjustment and polishing kit to finish the residual sprue area down. Any fine grit diamond burr can also work well. After a quick try-in to check the fit and the contacts, I continue polishing with the polishing wheels from the BruxZir adjustment and polishing kit. Here I'm using the brown disc polisher to pre-polish and remove any fine surface scratches, and then we move on to the blue disc for a nice high shine. Since I'm planning to bond these restorations in, we air braid the intaglio with 50 micron aluminum oxide using this Danville Chairside micro etcher. This will help create a roughened internal surface to improve the bond, and it also removes any salivary contaminants that may be on the crowns from the try-in. If you're using restorations from the lab, an alternative to air abrasion to remove contaminants are these special zirconia cleaners, such as Ivoclar's Ivoclean. Here, our RDA Will is demonstrating how to use this. We place a drop of the material inside and scrub for 20 seconds, and then you rinse and dry. You now have a clean surface to bond to. Since we're bonding, we now place Ivoclar's Monobond Plus, which has the right phosphate monomers to prime zirconia. This is applied on the entire internal surface and the margins and allowed to react for a minute. It will typically air dry on its own. Now to cement these in, I'm using the same adhesive resin we used to lock those fiber posts in place, 3M's RelyX Ultimate. Since it's an adhesive cement, their adhesive, Scotchbond Universal, is applied on the preps and air thinned. You have the option to light cure or not light cure. If you plan to cure, really make sure you thin the material down to avoid pooling, which could interfere with the complete seating of your restorations. With the cement loaded in the crowns, I seat each down slowly onto the preps. Since this is a dual cure resin, it will eventually fully set on its own, but I like to tack cure for about 2 to 3 seconds to reach a gel phase where we can begin picking off the excess. Now, looking at the removal, it's a hair past the ideal gel phase for easier removal. A little more force on my scaler is needed to remove the excess, but it isn't too bad. Every cement, curing light, distance, position, even its power will be slightly different. If you haven't found that perfect gel state, start low and gradually work your way up in time. I've got a prosthodontist friend that actually prefers fully curing before cleaning the excess, and that works for him. I guess there's something good knowing the restorations aren't going anywhere, but for myself, I just find it way less traumatic for the patient if I can take most of the cement off while it's soft. After the bulk is removed from the facial, the lingual, and interproximal areas, we do a full light cure just to make sure things are set right. The research has shown mechanical properties of dual cure resins are better when cured with a light. All right, we're almost home free. We're now checking along the margins and interproximal areas to remove any last bits of remaining cement and then check the occlusion and make any necessary adjustments. Let's take a look at this final transformation from PFMs to these in-office fabricated BruxZir aesthetic crowns. Take note of the soft tissue appearance. With light transmission increased from virtually zero with the PFMs, the tissue looks much nicer and healthier. Despite this being monolithic zirconia, the translucency has now reached levels on par with natural dentition. I was honestly a bit skeptical about using a material straight from the mill to the patient in these anterior situations, but I was pleasantly surprised at how nicely these restorations blended in with the rest of her natural dentition. I continue to be amazed at what we're able to accomplish with this robust, versatile chairside CAD/CAM system. The future is here, folks. This is the easiest way to take control of single unit fabrication in your practice, and also for putting smiles on our patients' faces. Because really, at the end of the day, that's why we do what we do. On behalf of everyone at Glidewell, thank you for your time. Are you enjoying this instructional video? I hope so. If you'd like to receive additional clinical instruction with AGD and ADA approved CE credits, all at no charge, be sure to visit glidewelldental.com/education, where in addition to over 60 on-demand clinical courses, you can also access our weekly webinars along with other valuable content.